Hi, hello, good morning everyone. This is CA Kaushik Mukesh. We are going to start our first revision session on the Foreign Exchange and Management Act 1999. So these are certain list of abbreviations that were used in the course of our discussion of the chapter called as a FEMA. So FEMA, PRI, PROI, TC, Traveler's Checks, LOC, Letters of Credit, BOI, Bills of Exchange, FC, Foreign Currency, IC, Indian Currency, FE, Foreign Exchange, OBA, Office, Branch or an Agency, EDF, Export Declaration Form, PFI, Previous Financial, CFI, Current Financial, ORC, Owned or Controlled, CAT, Capital Account Transaction, CRAT, Current Account Transaction. First thing, before we start with the video lecture, first I want to make it very clear that this is not a normal direct regular session. This will be a revision session. Therefore, I just don't want to waste the time in discussing about unnecessary aspects like historic setting of FEMA, and I don't want to waste the time in these lectures. I just want to stick on to the subject that is applicable for our exams. So, timeline of foreign exchange status in India. Impact of FEMA. You can just pause the video and look it into the statistics. I don't want to waste the time even in this, just to have an overall glance. 1991, it started with 1.1 billion. 2019, it ended up with 414.15 billion. Let us take 415 for example. If you take like that, 1991 and 2019. So between this time gap, it has increased from 1 to 414. That means 400 times increase is there. So this is the impact of FEMA in India. By the way, 1991 FERA is there, not FEMA. But 2000, it is 38, it become 414.15 billion. 2000 means FEMA came, very recently FEMA came. 2000 to 2019, that means technically you can take totally 19 years into existence or 20 years as a rounded number. For full completed 20 years, it has become from, it came from 38 to $414.15 billion. FEMA. So the basic definitions of the FEMA has its importance. First one. Preamble of a FEMA. What is a preamble? Preamble means the objective for which the act has come into existence. What is the preamble of FEMA? FEMA is an act to consolidate and amend the law relating to foreign exchange. What is consolidate? What is amend the law? Amend the law means already original act is there with the name called as FERA. FERA was amended. Not with the name called as a FERA Amendment Act. That amendment has given rise to a new act called as FEMA, and the old FERA has been repealed. Repealed means totally taken away. So consolidate, that means it want to consolidate the ideas of FERA and new ideas under FEMA and consolidate into a single law called as a FEMA with an objective. What is the objective of FEMA? Facilitate external trade. External trade means what? External trade can be of two types. It can be both imports or exports. Okay, next issue, that means promotion of imports and exports is the idea behind the concept of FEMA. Not only imports and exports, many concepts will be there in the progress of discussion of the chapter FEMA. We'll be knowing that, but at the beginning stage of understanding, we can understand as an imports and exports with an objective of promoting orderly development of a forex market in India. What is development is okay. What is orderly development? Orderly development means there should be some person to order you. There should be some person to direct you. Who is that person to direct me? First one is the apex body for the FEMA being RBI. Sir, can RBI do everything? RBI has hundreds and lakhs of works every day. Can RBI do everything? Therefore, RBI has given all the order development powers, etc. to a party called as an authorized person. This authorized person is covered by 10, 11 and 12 sections of the act called as FEMA. Next one, short title, extent and commencement. What is the name of the act? What is the extent of applicability? And what is the commencement and idea behind this concept? First one, name of the act, Foreign Exchange Management Act 1999. Extendability, it extends to whole of India, including the state of Jammu Kashmir. You need not even remember now, every act is applicable even to the state of Jammu Kashmir. Next one, extraterritorial jurisdiction. That means old FERA concentrated only on taking into account the citizens of India. Citizens not of India, not the citizen of India, then what will be the situation? Then FERA has nothing to do. The jurisdiction of FERA can't extend beyond the citizens of India. But FEMA will be taking into consideration both the Indian residents as well as foreign residents. So also applicable to the overseas branches and agencies outside India. So before going into the legal structure, let me first explain you one very important concept called as demarcation of FERA with FEMA. a very good doubt will come. So just now you said that we are not going to waste the time in understanding the old act. Then why we are again discussing about the demarcation between FERA and FEMA? There is one small requirement. So you can see here. The highlighted point you can observe, C point I mean, sorry. See there, foreign exchange acquired or received before 8th day of July 1947 or any income arising or accruing thereon, which is held outside India by a person in presence of a general or special permission granted by RBI. This is a sentence used. Meaning we will come there, section number 7 and 8, then we will discuss. But what is so great about 8th July 1947? 8th July 1947, it's not Independence Day. 8th July 1947, it's not Republic Day. It's not any other eminent person's birthday. Then what is so remarkable about that 8th July? 8th July is a date of birth of FERA. Therefore, to some extent, to a very much a minimal extent, we need to understand what is the law prevalent in India before FEMA. For that purpose, this demarcation will surely help you. Origin of FERA 1947, amended 1973, FEMA 1999. Extraterritorial jurisdiction, just now I told you, it is applicable also for outside India. Which one? FEMA. And FERA? No. Next one, objective. Conserve foreign exchange. That means please conserve as much foreign exchange as required. Therefore, don't let the foreign exchange to flow outside India. Next one, facilitating external trade. Do whatever you want for promotion of external trade in India. That means trade increase is the idea behind FEMA. Preserving is the idea behind FERA. Next one, violations. In FERA, all the violations will be of a criminal nature. Everything will be prosecuted in a criminal court. Means a trial court or a sessions court. But in FEMA, everything will be a civil case only. Therefore, adjudications will be done under FEMA. Crimes will be prosecuted. Civil cases will be adjudicated by the adjudicating authorities. Here also adjudicating authorities are there. We will see in section number 16, 17 and so on. And 38, 39 and 40. There we will come 36, 37, 38, 39, 40. All these sections will be talking about the civil adjudications under FEMA. Next one. But one important point. There is a small exception to this. Generally, we think that all cases under FEMA are civil nature. But it is certainly not. 2018, FEMA has came out with an amendment. Rather, it is not an amendment to FEMA. It is an amendment made to the Finance Act, which has brought out three, four new subsections called as Section 13, Subsection 1A, 1B, 1C, 1D, capital A, capital B, capital C, capital D, which has brought out criminal prosecutions under FEMA. So what is about that? We will discuss when we come to section number 13. So generally 99% of the cases civil, but in one simple important case, it becomes a criminal case, will be prosecuted by a criminal court called as a sessions court or a trial courts. Next one, compoundable, non-compoundable. It is non-compoundable and it is compoundable. What is compoundable, non-compoundable? When we come to section number 15, we will be discussing about that. Next one, criteria of applicability. Citizenship is the criteria. Here, residential status. This residential status and income tax residential status, both are not at all same. Both are completely different in their intentions. Next one, types of transactions. Under FERA, there are no transaction details. I just want to tell one important point here. FERA has given a positive list. FEMA will be giving negative list. FERA will be giving a positive list. What do you mean positive list? FERA will tell these you can do, others cannot do. That means whatever is not permitted in the positive will come into the negative list under FERA. And in FEMA, whatever is not specified in the positive list will come into the negative. That means in FEMA, most of the transactions are permitted. Whatever is not permitted will become prohibited under FEMA. But under old FERA, I will specify the negative transactions. Beyond that negative transaction, everything will become a positive transaction for our applicability. I think everyone is clear up to here. Next issue. Foreign Exchange Management Act, there are certain important definitions to discuss on. So what are the definitions? Before going into that, I just want to take this very important chart. First one, legal structure of FEMA. This is how the FEMA has been drafted by the lawmaker. First one, the charging section of FEMA is provided by section number 3 and section number 4 of FEMA. And once the charging section is done, there are two types of transactions, legal transactions and illegal transactions under FEMA. Legal transactions are again divided into two categories, disclosed legal transactions, undisclosed legal transactions. Legal transactions, once disclosed, they are again divided into two categories, inflows and outflows. inflows are governed by section number 7, 8 and 9, export rules and realization and repatriation upon receipt of the proceeds of foreign exchange. So export rules and realization repatriation are governed by inflows and outflows under FEMA. Outflows under FEMA are discussed in two ways, direct and indirect. Direct P&L trading account transactions will be there. Those are called as imports, governed by import rules and regulations. And outflows, again there are indirect outflows. Indirect means, let me explain one important point in this connection. Point number one, I'm not making any import or export of a import or export of any goods and services, etc. I am making a transaction of a personal nature, or I am making a transaction which is of a indirect in nature. Example, I am making a salary to a foreign person. That means I am paying salary to a non-resident. It will not be an import. Then it will come into what? It will come into the current account transaction. I am giving only one example. When we come to section number 5, we'll be discussing about lot many transactions which are covered by FEMA in terms of indirect P&L transaction. For example, I am not going to do that. I'm going to purchase a building in USA. I'm going to purchase a building in Singapore. I want to purchase a hotel in Singapore. I want to invest in shares of a Japanese company. I want to invest in debentures of a German company. Then all these things are imports? No, they are not imports. Then which will take over? Capital account transactions under FEMA. So I repeat once again, legal structure of FEMA, legal and illegal. Legal, disclosed, undisclosed. Disclosed transactions are again divided into two parts, exports and realization repatriation, section number 7, 8, 9, and outflows, import rules and indirect P&L and balance sheet. P&L comes to CAT, balance sheet, sorry, CRAT, balance sheet will come to CAT. Okay, that means section number 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, section number 3, 4, 1 and 2, preamble and certain definitions, 1, 2. Now we are going to discuss about definitions. Once I discuss about legal structure, that means section number 1 preamble, just now we completed. Section number 2 definitions, we are going to complete it. Charging section, section number 3 and section number 4 will be the charging sections. We will be discussing that. 5 current account, 6 capital account, 7 exports, 8 and 9 realization repatriation. Now understand one important concept. Whenever transaction is of a legal nature, inflows and outflows can be there. Whenever inflows and outflows, inflows means I will get foreign exchange, outflows means I will pay foreign exchange. From whom you will receive, from whom you will pay, that is very important point to understand. First thing is, we will receive and we will pay through one very important party called as authorized person. This person is governed by section number 10, 11 and 12 of FEMA. So 3 and 4 charging sections, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11 and 12. Now, if you disclose, this is the idea. I didn't make a disclosure properly. I contravened the provisions of FEMA. Then what will happen? Automatically, section 13, 14, 15 and other adjudication sections will get attracted. That means in FEMA, we can divide it into two parts. First 15 sections and all the other sections. First 15 sections of FEMA forming part of the heart and core. That means the main ideas of FEMA are reflected in section number 1 to section number 15. And that's how it was drafted by the lawmaker. That means, in a nutshell, let me explain how it used to and how it looked like. See here. This is the original structure of FEMA. Charging section 3 and 4, legal structure of FEMA, legal and illegal, disclosed, undisclosed, inflows, outflows. These are the various sections to understand. Now question will come. Sir, disclosed, understood, undisclosed, also understood. Then what about illegal? Illegal transactions in foreign exchange are not governed by FEMA. It is governed by a separate act called as SAFEMA. So what is SAFEMA? It's the original name is not SAFEMA, that is an acronym. The original name of SAFEMA is Smugglers and Foreign Exchange Manipulators Act. Smugglers and Foreign Exchange Manipulators Act is the idea behind the concept called as SAFEMA. SAFEMA covers the hawala transactions. So this is how the foreign exchange transactions will be understood through a structure. Next issue. Let us now move into the definitions of foreign exchange. So what is a foreign exchange? And how it has to be understood. Foreign exchange does not just mean a dollar or any other thing. For example, For example, to understand in a different way, I can tell like this. For example, this is a dollar currency. For example, let us take like this. So, understand in this way. First one, foreign exchange means what? Foreign exchange means foreign currency. That's all. Completed. Foreign exchange is not just restricted to the paperized notes. It is not just currency. It also includes deposits, credits, and balances payable in foreign currency. What do you mean by deposits, balances payable in foreign currency? Let me explain. So, you can understand this way. For example, this is a global debit card released by State Bank of India. This is called as international debit card. That means you can use worldwide and globally wherever possible with some restrictions and laws applicable. That means one thing I want to tell you, that means foreign exchange does not just mean foreign currency. It also includes deposits, credits, and balances payable. That means foreign exchange means foreign currency. This is a foreign currency. It also includes deposits, credits, and balances payable. Deposits. That means I have paper currency in the form of dollars. Is it a foreign exchange? Yes, it is a foreign exchange. I don't have paper currency. I have foreign exchange in my debit card. Is it a foreign exchange? Yes, it is a foreign exchange, provided it should be convertible into dollars. Next one. Credits and balances payable. Whenever there is a credit, I will receive. Whenever there is a balance payable, I have to pay. So therefore, all kinds of receivables and payables in foreign exchange in your balance sheet will also be called as a foreign exchange. That means when you repeat this, I will be like in this way. Point number one, foreign exchange means foreign currency, paper currency. And foreign currency is also having a definition, not just paper is a currency. What it is, we will discuss there. So foreign exchange means foreign currency, and foreign currency and includes the following. Deposits, credits, and balances payable in foreign currency. That means deposits, credits, and balances payable. I made a deposit in a foreign exchange account. Is it a foreign exchange? Yes, it is a foreign exchange. I have a credit card. Is it a foreign exchange? Yes, it is a foreign exchange. I have some balances receivable and payable. Are they called as a foreign exchange? Yes, they will be called as a foreign exchange. So foreign exchange means a foreign currency and includes deposits, credits, and balances payable in foreign currency. Next issue, drafts, traveler's checks, letters of credit, bills of exchange. What are all these? For example, if you want to have a look into this. So, this is a check denominated in foreign exchange. For example, if you want to take this as an example, see here. This was denominated in rupees or in dollars. For example, you have made an export. Once you make an export, the person has to make you a payment. Payment was released in the form of a foreign exchange check to you. You have to encash it with an authorized person called as a repatriation. Okay. Now try to understand clearly. This is a check denominated in a foreign currency called as a dollar. Then how to interpret this? Now, foreign exchange means, if I tell foreign exchange means foreign currency, they will tell that Czech is not a currency, therefore it is outside the purview of FEMA. No. Therefore, in order to magnify the amplitude and gravity of the act called as FEMA, everything has been brought into the definition of foreign exchange as much as possible. Foreign exchange means not only a foreign currency. Foreign exchange means foreign currency and deposits, credits and balances payable in foreign currency. Deposits, credits and balances payable in foreign currency. Deposits, credits and balances payable. Next one. Drafts, travelers checks, letters of credit, bills of exchange. Drafts, foreign exchange drafts will be there. This may be a draft. So this will also be encashable in India. That means this is also a foreign exchange. Sir, what is a traveler's check and how it look like? So this is how the traveler's check will look like. Traveler's check, name itself is there, travelers. It will be given only to the travelers in India. That means traveler's check will be given only to those who will be going on to a onward journey to an outside country. Traveler's checks in India, if you look at, see here, it will be given in the following way. Indian Overseas Bank, State Bank of India. Let me take this as an example and explain. This is a State Bank of India's traveler's check. So when a person from outside India comes to India, then State Bank of India will give you this traveler's check in order to have a easy convertibility. First example and the first reason why traveler's check will be issued means, since a possession of a foreign currency on hand in the form of a physical cash is very dangerous and it is risky and it is also difficult to possess the foreign exchange. Whenever you go to a place outside India, give your rupees, tender it into a for traveler's check such that it will be denominated in a foreign exchange. Whenever you go to some 5-star hotels, etc., they will obviously accept traveler's checks directly. They will encash with their respective banker. So how it will be done, we will see later. But this is the idea behind the concept of traveler's check. So this is one point that I want to discuss on. So one thing at a final level, foreign exchange means what? In a nutshell, foreign exchange means a foreign currency. Not just a foreign currency, it also includes many things inside that. Especially, foreign exchange means foreign currency and includes the following: deposits, credits and balances payable in foreign currency, and drafts, traveler's checks, letters of credit, bills of exchange, expressed or drawn in foreign currency but payable in Indian currency. Expressed or drawn in Indian currency but payable in foreign currency. What is this expressed or drawn in foreign currency but payable in Indian currency? From this, we can have four different permutations possible. See here. Illustration on drafts, traveler's checks and letters of credit. Particulars. Expressed or drawn in. You can observe this. Expressed or drawn in foreign currency but payable in Indian currency. Expressed or drawn in Indian currency but payable in foreign currency. Both are includable. Let's check the first one. Particulars. Case 1, case 2, case 3 and case 4. Expressed or drawn in Indian currency and payable in Indian currency. Is this a foreign exchange? No. Expressed or drawn in rupees, that means Indian currency, and payable in foreign currency. Is this a foreign exchange? Yes. Expressed or drawn in foreign currency and payable in Indian currency. Is it a foreign exchange? Yes. Expressed or drawn in foreign exchange, foreign currency and payable in foreign currency. Is this a foreign exchange? No. So this is the idea behind the definition. Next one. What is a foreign currency? Foreign currency means any currency other than Indian currency. Then what is an Indian currency? Don't tell any currency other than Indian foreign currency. Indian currency is having a definition. Whatever is not Indian currency will become a foreign currency. That means whatever is not an Indian currency, that will become a foreign currency. Then what is Indian currency? Indian currency means a currency which is expressed or drawn in INR, Indian rupees. That means Indian, that's called as Indian currency. It shall not include the special banknotes and special 1 rupee note. These are not into the legal tenderance in circulation. Special banknotes and special 1 rupee notes. So when you have a nutshell of a discussion, foreign currency means any currency other than Indian currency. Then what is an Indian currency? Indian currency means a currency expressed or drawn in Indian rupees. 100 rupees note. Is it an Indian currency? Yes, because it is expressed or drawn in Indian rupees. As simple as that. Next one. Currency includes. What are the definitions we discussed now? Foreign exchange, foreign currency, Indian currency. Now we are going into the definition of the term currency. Then what is a currency? Currency includes. It's an inclusive definition. Includes what? All currency notes, postal notes, postal orders, money orders, checks, drafts, traveler's checks, letter of credit, bills of exchange, promissory notes and credit cards. Everything will be defined into the meaning of the term currency. One, you should understand foreign exchange, foreign currency, Indian currency and currency. That means when you start from the beginning stage, first thing is there should be a currency. There is an Indian currency. Which is not an Indian currency will become a foreign currency. Foreign exchange includes this foreign currency, but it's not means foreign currency. It includes. That means inclusive definition means what? Many things are there. This is one example. So foreign exchange includes foreign currency and it means a foreign currency and includes many other things like drafts, travelers, checks, letters of credit, deposits, payables, etc. That means in a nutshell revision, foreign exchange means foreign currency includes drafts, traveler's checks, letters of credit, deposits, payables and credits in foreign currency. Next one, foreign currency means any currency other than Indian currency. Indian currency is which is expressed or drawn in Indian rupees and currency means all these aspects. Currency notes. Currency notes means and includes cash in the form of coins and banknotes. Banknotes means currency notes. Currency notes. Does not mean only the paper notes, it also includes coins. Next one, person. This is very, very important concept. See here. Under FEMA, persons are actually divided into two categories. Persons resident in India, persons resident outside India. First one is a person resident in India. Second one is a person resident outside India. Who is a person resident in India? We will discuss. Person resident outside India also we have to discuss. But first thing is resident in India, resident outside India, well and good. What do you mean by the term person? Therefore, person definition. Person includes. This is also an inclusive definition. These are some examples. If a new person got in existence under any act in India at a later point of time, that shall also be brought into the purview of the definition of the term person. So person includes what? Individual, HUF, company, firm, AOP, BOI, AGP and office, branch or an agency owned or controlled by such person. Simply, I want to tell you one thing. Act is applicable to every person including their offices and branches. Very important concept, residential status. As I already said you, residential status, definition of a person, definition of person resident in India, definition of a person resident outside India. We already completed person definition to be inclusive in nature and it includes everyone into it. So that's what we have already discussed. So now we are going into the next concept called as residential status. Very, very important and it will take a very good time. So we will also do some practical illustrations today, which were given in the past examinations in CA. So let us start with our discussion on residential status. So first thing, what is the importance of residential status under FEMA? Why I have to discuss about the definition of PRI and PROI? Why it is so important to learn who is a resident and who is a non-resident? And what is the importance? Everywhere in FEMA, the applicability of the section will be dependent on who you are. Means what? Capital account transactions will be there. They will tell that these transactions are prohibited for a PROI. Then it is permitted to whom? PRI. Then who I am? PRI or PROI? It will be dependent on this definition. Next one. Realization, repatriation will be there. Different kinds of time limits will be given for PRIs and PROIs. Then who you are, refer to the definition. I made an export. Realization, repatriation depends on that. And whenever you want to make an export, during the export, we have to disclose a form called as an export declaration form. In that export declaration form, we need to clearly disclose that you are a resident, that means a PRI. To know whether you are a PRI or PROA, how can you know directly? You can't disclose by yourself. It has to be according to the law. Law says this is a definition of person resident in India. So how to understand this? Actually, the bare text of the law is in this following way. Just I want to read it for you once, then we will go into the chart. Person resident in India means a person residing in India for more than 182 days during the course of a preceding financial year, but does not include a person who has gone out of India or who stays outside India in the either case for or on taking up employment outside India or for carrying on outside India a business or occasion in India, outside India, or for any other purpose in such circumstances as would indicate his intention to stay outside India for an uncertain period. A person who has come to or stays in India in either case other than for or on taking up employment in India or for carrying on in India a business or occasion in India or for any other purpose in such circumstances as would indicate his intention to stay in India for an uncertain period. Any person or a body corporate registered or incorporated in India, any office branch or an agency in India owned or controlled by a person resident outside India, an office branch or an agency outside India owned or controlled by a person resident in India. Now, the funniest part is, once after completion of this definition, everyone will feel, except India, we didn't understand anything in this definition. Yes, that will be the feeling. But we have to make it very clear, because almost in 20 to 25 different circumstances, institute has asked this question. That means this question is the highest number of repeated questions in the CA law history itself. Many number of times it has been asked. I'm talking about since the inception of this concept of FEMA in our syllabus, it has been asked almost what 20 to 25 times. That much importance has been relied on this definition of residential status. So let us have a clear glance. Point number one, before we go into chart, first I want to explain one thing. For example, this is India. Don't laugh at the diagram. I am very poor at them, but still try to understand the idea behind. Person resident in India. Whenever we discuss about this, two things will happen. Definition of person resident in India and person resident outside India is one important definition where we need to understand one important point. First issue, you can either be called as, you can either be called as a PRI or a PROI. You can be either called as a PRI or PROI. You can be called as PRI or PROI. When will I become a PRI? When will I become a, when will I become a PRA? Residential status is broadly classified into two parts. Checking the previous financial year status, checking the current financial year status. That means residential status under Income Tax Act and residential status under the FEMA, both are not at all same. Here under FEMA, we should understand one very important point. To confirm whether a person is a person resident in India or a person resident outside India, we need to check two things. Previous financial year status, current financial year status. What is his status in the previous financial year? What is his status in the current financial year? So, point number one. See here. Person resident in India. First thing. Query number one. Have you stayed in India for more than 182 days in the previous financial year? You can get two types of answers. Red color implies no. Green color implies yes, always. That's a general idea. So, person resident in India, to confirm, first we need to go through the definition. Have you stayed in India for more than 182 days in the previous financial year? He may either tell yes, he may either tell no. If his answer is no, confirm that he is a PROI. Next issue. Second one. Person resident in India. You have asked one important question that have you stayed in India for more than 182 days in the previous financial year? The person has given an answer that it is yes. Yes, I stayed in India for more than 182 days in the preceding financial year. If the answer is yes, don't confirm that he is a PRI. Immediately go and ask him another question. Have you been static during the current financial year? Static means, this is a word I have used for easy understanding. What do you mean by the word static here? That means, are you moving out of India and coming to India during the current financial year? He said that no, in the previous financial year, I was there in India for the complete year or at least for more than 182 days. And in this current financial year, I didn't go anywhere in India. I am completely in India only. I am not going outside India, and I haven't come to India from any other country. From the first, let us start. Person resident in India. Have you stayed in India for more than 182 days in the preceding financial year? He said no. PROI, person resident outside India. And he said yes. Don't confirm that he is a person resident in India. Ask him another question. Are you static? Are you flexible? He said that I am static. I didn't come to India. I am not going outside India in the current financial year. Confirm that he is a PRI. He said that, have you been static? That is my question. Immediately he said that, I am not static. I am flexible. Flexible, that means, are you static? Answer is no. Immediately I asked, that means you are flexible. He said, yes, I am flexible. That means I am going outside India and I am coming to India. Immediately I asked a question. If you are flexible, have you gone outside India in the current financial year? That means I asked him a question. Have you been static? He said, no, I'm flexible. Flexible means which type of flexibility? Coming to India, going outside India. I asked, have you gone outside India? Immediately he said that, yes, I have gone outside India. Immediately I asked, for what purpose you have gone outside India? For specified three purposes. What are the three specified purposes? I will tell you later. So first, listen to the basic idea behind the definition. I asked him, have you gone out for any of the three purposes? He said yes. Then I disclaim him as a PROI. He said no. Then I will be calling him as a PRI. And in the same way, I asked him, have you gone outside India? First, he said that I'm not static. That means he's flexible. Have you gone outside India? No. Flexible, but not gone outside India means what would have happened? It implies that he came to India. Came to India for what purpose? For three purposes? He said yes. Then he will become a PRI. He said no. He will become PROI. I am not explaining the definition. I just read my chart prepared. Now I will be going into the explanatory part. First thing. Two things will happen. Whenever you want to know whether a person is a resident or not, divide it into two parts. Preceding financial year, current financial year. What is his status in the preceding financial year? Two situations can happen. More than 182 days stay in India, not more than 182 days stay in India. If the first answer is there, go for the second one. This is condition one, this is condition two. Then only we can confirm that a person is a person resident in India or outside India. Condition number one, he said that I am more than 180 days stay in India. Then go for second condition and check. He said that I am only for 150 days. Then don't even check the second condition. He will be obviously called as a PROI. That means the residential status of the current financial year will be dependent on the previous financial year. So stay in India. If you stayed in India for more than 180 days, I will call you as a resident, provided you satisfy second condition. I satisfied condition one, but I didn't satisfy second condition. I am a PRI. No, you are a PROI. That means two conditions have to be cumulatively satisfied, and how it will be, let us try to understand in detail. Point number one. Three purposes. What are the three specified purposes? Number one, employment. Number two, business or vocation. Number three, uncertain period of stay. Uncertain period of stay. Let me explain. These three are notified three areas where there will be an established permanence. means what? What exactly permanence means? I am going for an employment outside India for 5 years. Permanency is established in India or outside India? Obviously outside India. I am going to have my establishment outside India. That means I am going to start a company outside India. If I start a company outside India, my business will be, business establishment is incorporated outside India or not? That means my incorporation, since the business is done outside India, I have an established business place outside India and permanency will be established outside India, then I will be called as a, and this attaches some amount of permanency. Once I repeat, it will be like this. An individual is going outside India for the purpose of employment for 3 years, 4 years, 5 years, etc. Once you go out for employment for 2 years, 3 years, 4 years, etc., your permanency is increasing in India or outside India? Outside India. Next one, business or occasion. I'm going outside India for a conducting a business and I want to stay there for the business purpose. Now your permanency will be established in India or outside India? Outside India. I'm going outside India. A person asked me, why you are going outside India? I'm going outside India for this particular purpose. Up to when you will be there? Uncertain. I don't know when I will be returning back. That means you have a clarity of going out, but you don't have a clarity of returning back to India. That means it is uncertain whether you come back or not. Permanency is established again. Technically, you can understand like this. Three notified areas of employment, business or occasion, and uncertain period of stay. These three areas are attaching some amount of permanency to them. That means, for example, I can contrast and tell you another example. I went to visa check. He asked, where you are going? I said, I'm going to USA. Okay, now I want to know whether on the date of my journey to USA, I want to know whether I will be a PRIR, PRO. He asked me, where you are going? I'm leaving to USA. What is the purpose? Sightseeing. That means I want to visit USA and come back. Visiting USA and coming back means it's just a sightseeing. Now the permanency will be, once you go for a visit, you will be staying there. You will become a permanent resident of USA. No, there is a temporariness in your existence in USA. That means if I go for employment, I'm going for a permanent employment is having its own definition. Employment means you should not go on retainership basis from Indian company. There is a definition for employment, that employment you are going. That means I'm going on an employment outside India for 3 years. Now your permanency is attached and established in India or outside India? Outside India. Same will happen even in India. A person is there outside India. He's coming to India. I asked him, why you are coming? I want to visit some important places in India for tourism. That means a person who comes for tourism will stay in India? No, he will be again going back. That person is coming for the three other than for three. Sightseeing is other than three. He said, why you are coming? I want to meet my relatives and go out. Employment? No. Business or occasion? No. Uncertain period? As of now, he didn't tell anything. Therefore, again, you will not be coming into any of the three category. So one thing we should keep in mind, these three areas are attaching some amount of permanency in stay, whether in India or outside India. I'm going on employment outside India to USA. Permanency attaches there. A person from USA coming to India for employment, permanency attaches here. So these three areas are attaching some amount of permanency. One thing to keep in mind, employment, business or occasion, uncertain period of stay. Remember like this. So these are called as three purposes. Let us go back to the chart. Let us see this and understand. So point number one. So please concentrate everyone. Person resident in India. I asked him a question. Have you stayed in India for more than 182 days in the previous financial year? He said, no. I stayed in India for only for 125 days. You are a PROI. You are a PROI. Next issue. Person resident in India. I asked him, have you stayed in India for more than 180 days in the preceding financial year? He said that I am there in India for the full year. That means for more than 180 days. Answer is yes. Immediately I asked him another counter question. Have you been static during the current financial year? I asked him, okay, previous financial you are there for more than 180 days, no problem. In the current financial, as on the date of calculating the status of residence, I asked him, in the current financial year, at any point of time, have you left India or have you come to India? He said that I am static or flexible. I asked him. He said that no, sir, I haven't gone to any country in my lifetime till date, and even in the current financial, I didn't cross the borders of India. I'm there in India. Who will come into this net? You and me will come into this net. Almost everyone will come into this net. you are not going out of India at any point of time. I am also in India throughout the year. Then we all will be called as a person resident in India. So person resident in India, have you stayed in India for more than 180 days in the preceding financial year? Answer is yes. And I asked him a question, have you been static? He said yes. Then you are a PRI. Up to here, I think you have a clarity. If you have any kind of doubt in this regard, please put me a message. In the comment section, you can make your comments, or if the comment section is not open, you can at least make a personal message to me with regard to any kind of doubts with regard to the residence. Next one. Have you stayed in India for more than 182 days in the preceding financial year? The answer is yes. And have you been static? The answer is yes. Person resident in India. I asked him a question. Have you been static? Yes. Have you been stayed in India for more than 182 days? Yes. Have you been static? No. Previous financial year, I'm there in India for 190 days. After 190th day, I went to USA. Okay. That means in the previous financial year, you satisfied the residential, you satisfied the status of stay for 182 days and more than 182 days, and you went back. That means in the previous financial year, for example, I was there in India from April till December. Completely I was there. April, May, June, July, August, September, October, November, December. That means 9 months I've been there in India. After 9 months, I left India and went out. That means condition of stay of 182 days in the preceding financial year was satisfied and went back. Now, I asked him, have you been static during the current financial year? He said, no. Current financial year, no. Then I asked him, have you gone outside India in the current financial year? No. He said that, no, I didn't go in the current financial year. I went in the previous financial year. But in the current financial year, what you have done? He said that, I have come to India for the three purposes. Next issue. Have you stayed in India for more than 180 days in the preceding financial year? Answer is yes. Have you been static during the current financial year? He said that, no, I'm not static. I was flexible. Flexible means, I asked him a question, have you gone outside India for the current financial year? He said yes. For example, he said yes. I asked him, for what purposes you have gone outside India? Now get the three areas into existence. He said, yes, I have gone out of India. I asked him, have you gone for the three purposes? Three purposes are which three? Employment, business or occasion, uncertain period of stay. I asked him, have you gone out for employment? He said, yes, I already told you. Employment will have permanency in India or outside India. When you go outside India, for example, employment is permanent. Business is having a permanence. Uncertain existence is also having a permanence. That permanence is there in India or outside India. Have you gone outside India for three purposes? Yes, I have gone outside India. That means you are leaving India and going there for three purposes. That means you are going for employment. Permanency attaches there. You are a PROI. Business over there, PROI. Uncertainty over there, PROI. I asked him, have you gone out of India for three purposes? He said that, no, I'm going for sightseeing in the current financial year. Therefore, you are called as a PRI. Next one, have you gone outside India in the current financial year? He said, answer is no. That means, have you gone outside India in the current financial year? He said, no, I didn't go outside India. I came to India. Immediately, I asked him, come to India for which purpose? Three purposes. He said, yes, I'm coming for employment. Employment attaches a permanency in India. Therefore, yes, you are a PRI, or employment, or business or occasion, or uncertain period in India establishes a permanence in India. Therefore, you will be again called as a person resident in India. I asked him, have you been flexible? Yes, I'm flexible. Coming to India or going out of India in the current financial year? I came to India in the current financial year. You came to India in the current financial year for the three purposes? No, I came to India for a sightseeing. When a person comes to India for a sightseeing, permanence attaches in India or outside India? Outside India, not in India. Therefore, you are a PROI. So, this is a very big definition actually, which takes a full class time in a normal session. Just I try to complete in 15 to 20 minutes. But an overall review, this will be looking like this. First query, whenever question comes in examination, ask one question. Person resident in India, query number one, have you stayed in India for more than 182 days in the preceding financial year? He said, no, you are a PROI. Have you stayed in India for more than 182 days in the preceding financial year? He said, yes. Immediately when he tell yes, ask him, are you static in the current financial year? Yes, he said, you are a PRI. He said, no, I am not static. That means you are a flexible person, either coming to India or going out of India in the current financial year. Immediately ask him, have you been static during the current financial year? He said, no, I am not static. So then what you are? I'm going outside India, or he will say, I'm coming to India. I asked him, have you gone out of India in the current financial year? That means, are you leaving India? He said, yes, I'm leaving India. Immediately ask him, for what purpose? Is it for three purposes? You are going out of India for three purposes. That means three purposes will have a permanency or temporary permanency. Permanency is established outside India. Then permanency will not be there in India. Therefore, you are a PROI. He said, I'm going outside India. That is true, but not for three purposes, but for a sightseeing or a visit, etc. So no, PRI. And he said, I asked him, are you static? He said, no. Static means he's flexible, either coming to India or going out of India. I asked him, have you gone out of India? No. He's telling that he's flexible. And on the other hand, he's telling that I'm not going outside India. That means what it will be? He is there in the previous financial year for 182 days. He went outside India. And again, he is coming to India now. I asked him, why you are coming to India for the three purposes? He said, yes, I am coming for employment. Permanency is in India. Therefore, he is PRI. So he said, I am coming for sightseeing. I want to meet my relatives and go back. No permanence attaches because it is not coming into any of the three categories. It is a PROI. This is the idea behind this definition of person resident in India. Hope everyone understand the same. If you have any doubts, you can make a message. But still, we have to understand the illustrations on FEMA. So illustration number one. Mr. A had resided in India during the financial year 1999-2000 for less than 183 days. Try to understand one important point. Less than 183 days means one thing you need to understand. Less than 183. The definition uses the word more than 182 days. More than 182 days means it starts with 183 and more. If you are for less than 183, you will be 182 or lesser than 182. Therefore, condition number one itself is not satisfied. So first one, Mr. A had resided in India during the financial year 1999-2000 for less than 183 days. He had come to India on April 1st, 2000 for employment. What would be his residential status during the financial year 2000 and 2001? So one thing you can understand here, one important thing. So from the illustration, we can understand one important point here. So let me make one important point in this connection. See here, as per the query given, what he said, Mr. A had resided in India. Whenever question is given in examination, at least make a rough in the following way. 2000-2001, first thing. Mr. A had resided in India during the financial year 1999-2000 for less than 183 days. As I already said you in the chart, what is the first question you need to ask whenever the question was given from residential status? Have you stayed in India for more than 180 days in the preceding financial year? That is the first query we need to ask. So 1999-2000, what is the first question we need to ask? Have you stayed in India for more than 180 days in the preceding financial year? So during the financial year 1999-2000, he stayed for less than 183 days. That means Condition number one is, for more than 182 days, you must have stayed in India. Have you satisfied this condition? More than 182 days means it should start from 183. I'm staying for less than 183 means this condition is satisfied or not satisfied? Not satisfied. Previous financial year condition itself is not satisfied. Don't even ask him why he is coming to India or why he is going outside India. Simply, we can conclude that he is a person resident outside India for the financial year 2000 and 2001. This is a query number one. Next issue. What is the question that he has asked? First one. He had come to India on 1st April 2000 for employment. 1st April 2000 means which financial year it is falling into? 2000-2001. His idea is to come to India. That means coming to India. Coming to India for what? For employment. Employment is one among the three? Yes. All the three purposes what we have said are permanent or temporary? Permanent. He is coming to India for a permanent purpose, but still in the previous financial year, he was there in India for less than 182, was less than, not more than 182 days. Since he didn't satisfy the first condition, second condition becomes irrelevant, though he come to India for a permanent purpose. Let us check out the second query. So answer is also given. Mr. A had stayed in India for taking up employment. However, during the financial year 2000, he was in India for more, less than 182 days or 83 days. Since he has not fulfilled the condition of staying in India for more than 182 days, he cannot be considered as a person resident in India during the financial year 2000-2001, notwithstanding the purpose or duration. Second query, very important query, which will give you a good idea about the resident status understanding. I want every one of you, please take a note of this example as well. So please don't waste the time. So, let us understand in detail. Mr. X has resided in India during the financial year 1999-2000 for less than 183 days. That means he is staying in India for more than 183 days or less than 183 days? Less than 183 days during the 1999-2000. You may ask sir, same question again. No, this will have some important addition. So, let us first understand the basics. So, Mr. A had resided in India during the financial year 1999-2000 for less than 183 days. He had come to India on April 1st, 2000 for business. He intends to leave the business on April 30, 2001 and leave India on June 30, 2001. What would be his residential status during the financial year 2000-2001 and 2001-2002 up to the date of departure? Just I will give a time for you to read the question first. Please have a reading. So, Mr. X had resided in India during the financial 1999-2000 for less than 183. He had come to India on 1st April for business. You should always remember whether it is falling into the three purposes or not. He intends to leave the business on April 30, 2001 and leave India on June 30, 2001. What would be his residential status during the financial 2000-2001 and during 2001-2002 up to the date of departure? So, let's bifurcate. What I said every time, whenever a query is given, first we need to divide. Divided into two parts. Here he is asking the residential status for 1 year or for 2 years. 2 years. First one. He is asking residential status for 2000-2001 and he is also asking residential status for 2001-2002. Now everyone you should answer. 2000-2001 residential status current financial year. For that this is a current financial year. To know the residential status in the year 2000-2001, it is dependent on how he has been in the previous financial year 99-2000. And this will be dependent on 2000 and 2001. This will be dependent on its previous financial year. This will be dependent on this previous financial year. Query number one. What is the first question we need to ask them? Condition number one. Have you stayed in India for more than 182 days in the current financial year is a query one. In the current financial, that means in the 2000-2001, he came to India or he go outside India, he come to India 1st April. 1st April 2000, it belongs to 2000-2001 financial year. He come to India or went outside India, he came to India in the current financial year 2000-2001. That means what is the idea behind? He is coming to India for three purposes, not for three, for the three purposes. One purpose among the three, which is a business. So this is a permanent or temporary, permanent purpose he came. Though he is coming to India for a permanent purpose like the previous illustration I have what you have done, since his stay is not exceeding 182 days, he is a PROI. he came to India for a business. He stayed in India. 2000-2001 year, he has completely done his business in India and he is leaving India on June 30th, 2001. June 30th, 2001 means it belongs to 2001 and 2002 financial year. 2001-2002. 2000-2001, see here, he came to India on 1-4-2000 and he has been staying in India till 36-2001. That means he stayed in India from 2000 April to 2001 June. That means obviously his stay is more than 182 days or not. Yes, condition satisfied. Check for the second condition. Second condition, what we need to check, are you static or flexible? He said that I am flexible. Flexible means you are coming to India or going outside India. He said I am going out of India. I asked him, going out of India for what purpose? Going out of India, very good. Going out of India for what purpose? Don't misinterpret that for the business. Business, he came to India in 2000-2001, which became irrelevant because of his not being stay in India for more than 180 days in the preceding financial year, 1999-2000. I repeat once again, those who didn't understand, don't misinterpret. He is going outside India not for business. He is coming to India for business in the year 2000-2001. I am asking him, in the year 2001-2002, are you leaving India or coming to India? He said, I am leaving India. For what purpose? Don't tell business. Where he said in the question that it is for business. This is how the examination questions are being asked. He will corner you like this in exam. Here two interpretations will come. I am going outside India. That was only said in the question. I am going outside India. For what purpose? Two interpretations can come. In examination, you can interpret the answers in two ways. He is going outside India is clear. But going outside for what purpose? For the three, not for the three. You have to interpret in two ways. What are the two ways of interpretation? For the three, not for the three. If it is for the three, what will happen? I'm going outside India for the three. Those three purposes will be permanency or temporary. Permanency. Outside India for a permanent purpose makes you a PROI. Outside India for a temporary purpose will make you a PRI. So as simple as that. That means if you interpret the first way in examination, your answer will become PROI. If you interpret the second one, your answer will become PRI. That means first year anyway is a PROI. Second year depends on how you interpret. Institute has given both the answers. This is the answer. You can pause and read the answer. But one thing I want to tell. Accordingly, he would be resident in India during the financial 2000-2001 and 2002. However, if he leaves India for the purpose of taking up employment or for business or occasion or for the purpose which would indicate uncertain period, he would cease to be a person resident in India from the date of departure. Both the answers were given. That means if you interpret that he gone outside India not for the three, then he is a PRI. For the three, he will become a PROI. Next query. Mr. Z had resided in India during the financial year 1999-2000 and left India on 1st August 2000. First, let us have the answer here itself. First thing, what is the query? He said, 1999-2000 during the financial year, he resided in India during 1999-2000. First, let us take a situation. Previous financial year, current financial year. What happened? Mr. Z had resided in India during the financial year 1999-2000. He left India on 1st August 2000. 1st August 2000 will belong to 2000-2001 financial and 99-2000 financial year. Condition number 1. Is he there for more than 180 days? Full financial year is there. Condition 1 satisfied. Now, you should infer and answer. He left India on 1st August 2000. That means in this current financial year 2001-2002, he came to India or he gone outside India? He gone outside India. Gone outside India. You should check which purpose. He is going for higher studies. That means he is going for education for 3 years. Though it is for 3 years, first this year we need to confirm. Is education covered by any of the three? Education is business? No. Education is employment? No. Education is uncertain period? No. He is clearly telling that I will be for 3 years. That means he is going outside India for the three or not for the three? Not for the three purposes. That means he is a PRI in the current financial year. Everyone who is referring to the video will get a doubt. Sir, this is for 3 years. Then how can you call him as a PRI? No problem. Next year anyway, he will become PROI because of a 3 years stay. How? Let us try to understand. Now the second issue. 2001-2002 year means it depends on 2000-2001 and 2001 and 2002. Let us understand this. 2000-2001 year, is he there in India for more than 182 days? I went to USA on 1st August 2000. Okay, 1st August 2000, I went to USA. That means in the year 2000-2001, I am not there from August to April, August to March. That means my stay is for more than 182 or less than 182. Less than 1. That means it is not more than 182 days. Condition 1 is satisfied, not satisfied, not satisfied. It is irrelevant to check condition number 2. Therefore, he will obviously become a PROI, though he is a PRI in the previous financial year. This is how the answer will be given. So, hope everyone understand this particular lecture on residential status. If you have any specific doubts, you can always be free to message. That is all. Person resident in India for individuals. Obviously, going outside India, coming to India is possible for whom? For companies? No, for individuals. That's an individual residential status. Let us now move on to the residential status other than for the individuals. PRI, other than individuals. I have a company. I have a body corporate. That person or a body corporate is registered or incorporated in India. Once your company is incorporated in India, always it will be called as a PRI. Next one, I don't have a company, but I have a branch, office or an agency. So let us read like this. Office, branch or an agency in India owned or controlled by a person resident outside India. Physical existence is there in India. Technical control or ownership is there outside India. Or physical existence is there outside India, but control is there from India. In both the cases, India is involved either in physical establishment or in control or ownership. It will be called as a PRI. I repeat once again, office, branch or an agency in India, owned or controlled by person resident outside India. Though control and ownership is there from outside India, since physical existence is there in India, it will be called as a PRI. Okay, next one, branch, office or agency is there outside India, control is there from India, though office establishment is there outside India, since control is there in India, it is a PRI. Simply, lawmaker want to tell that every entity being an office, branch or an agency, if it is there, if it is having some control or ownership or some physical existence in India, it will be always called as a person resident in India. So this is all I want to convey from the first instance. And person resident outside India means whom? Person resident outside India means any person who is not a resident in India. If you are not a resident in India, obviously you are called as a person resident outside India. That means there is no separate definition for person resident outside India. If you are not PRI, automatically you will be called as a PROI. So this is the idea behind the definitions under FEMA. So these are all the points that I want to discuss with regard to the definitions part. So anyone having any kind of doubt with regard to the definitions, you can be free to ask me any kind of doubts in this regard. So this is the first lecture on FEMA. In the further lectures, we will be discussing about other points. But before leaving, I will be in nutshell covering out first abbreviations, next status of FEMA and purpose and preamble of FEMA. And next one, we discussed about the structure of FEMA, definitions we discussed. And after that, we came into the residential status definition and we have made a chart representation for that. So we have also done 3 exam questions in this regard. This is all about the revision on the first part of the FEMA chapter. This is what I want to convey. Next session, we will be coming with the export concepts under FEMA. So, but before leaving, one small exam question is there with regard to the residential status of entities not being individuals. Let us see this and leave. Toy is a Japanese company. That means one thing is clear, incorporated outside India. Just now I said any company incorporated in India is a PRI. If the toy company is a Japanese company incorporated in India or outside India, it will be obviously called as a PROI. Having several business units all over the world. It has a robotic unit. It has which unit? Robotic unit. Robotic unit with its headquarters in Mumbai. Who has a robotic unit? It has. That means it means a toy. Toy is a company incorporated in India or outside India. The toy company is having a headquarter in Mumbai. Headquarter means what? Office. Head office. Headquarter is called a head office. Office, branch or an agency. So office is in Mumbai. So how to interpret this? Office, branch or an agency in India owned or controlled by a person resident outside India. and has a, and it also has, Japanese company is also having a branch in Singapore. This is an office, this is a branch. Branch in Singapore. Headquarter at Mumbai controls the branch of robotic unit. Mumbai branch controls Singapore branch. Singapore branch means establishment is there in India or outside India? Outside India. A branch outside India which is controlled by a person resident in India. Obviously, this will become a PRI. To be very simple on this aspect, I can tell like this. Two things were given here. Toy is a Japanese company. Toy Japanese company is having two offices. Office one, branch. Office is there in Mumbai. Branch is there in Singapore. Toy is a company incorporated in Japan. Since the company is incorporated in Japan, is this a PRI or PROI? PROI. This PROI is having a head office in Mumbai. Now this is a PRI or PROI. This is an office in India owned or controlled by a PROI. Therefore, this becomes a PRI because of its physical existence in India. This Mumbai branch will control the Singapore branch. Mumbai office will control the Singapore branch. Singapore branch means establishment is in India or outside India. Though establishment is there outside India, controlled by a PRI, this will also become a PRI. Foreign exchange transactions made by this Singapore branch, made by this Mumbai branch, everything will be brought into control of FEMA. And even PROI will also be brought into the purview. Then why bifurcation? Some provisions are applicable for PROI, some provisions are applicable for PRI. So this is all about the concept. So hope this is helpful for everyone. We will be meeting again in our next session. Thank you.